Welcome to this special show, which is a result of what has just transpired in this country when a very special lady, Patience Museveni Rwabwogo, has successfully launched a very special book titled Jesus's Africa. And this book was so special that it brought special guests, including the one and only Reverend Jim Foley, and his very, very special partner, who swore to be with him till death parted them, on set today with us here. Welcome.
Thank you so much. We're very happy to be here with you.
Thank you.
I am also privileged to be the one to take charge of you in the next few minutes. It is a privilege of mine. I am told you are a special servant of God, but I don't have to tell the people who you are when you yourself are here with your best half. Please, let's know a little about who you are before I ask you why you are here and you came to be so privileged to be the one who delivered that wonderful keynote address at the launch. Welcome once again.
And I thank you so much, Tony. And please understand, I'm the one that's been honored. Mm-hmm. This is a wonderful privilege that I've been given to by you and certainly Uganda. Won't you understand that? I just retired after 50 years as pastor of the historic Little Rock Baptist Church in Detroit, Michigan.
50 years.
Okay. And the same church, 50 years, five generations, 50 years. And then, of course, what God did for me when I came out of pastoring, I went into evangelism. So right now, I have international ministries. And for the most part, I'm basically preaching around 200 countries around the world every week. And more than anything else, just really telling everybody about somebody who can save anybody. Mm-hmm. And that's Jesus Christ.
I'd like you to introduce your better half and let her tell us a little about you. Then I come back to you.
Just fine.
Yes.
Lodi is, we married about 10 months ago.
Okay.
We've been together about 12 years. I thought what we would do, and we went to God and basically asked God if she would wait for me for 12 years after I retire. Mm-hmm. And she did just that. Mm-hmm. And I'm so grateful to her and her family and have accepted me. And my family accepted her. And so it's just this sort of like a honeymoon for us, mm-hmm. so to speak.
Welcome once again.
Thank you so much.
What does it take to get to be married to a preacher? Are you also in the service of the Almighty?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes. I met him 12 years ago. I fell in love with him. He's a very nice gentleman. Everyone I talk to, they tell me you have a beautiful man, lovely man.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay. Now, tell me a little about how you came into the service of God, how you got born and grew up. You must have been in a turbulent period. I'm reliably informed you were involved with the one and only Martin Luther King Jr. Hmm. Tell us about that. It's rare to find someone who has rubbed shoulders with the icons.
You're very nice. God has always blessed me to be in history, mm-hmm. for one reason or another. Dr. King, I spent his last 3 years of his life with him. Jesse Jackson, who's my great good friend and basically my roommate in college.
The Reverend
Dr. Jackson, yes.
Was your roommate?
Right.
Go on.
And one of my best friends, and basically introduced me to Dr. King. But again, as I said before, God has always put me together. Like, for example, when Mandela came out of prison, I was there to help bring him to the United States. So I understand, Tony, that for the most part, all I can say is that God is always having to bump into history.
Wait a bit. Who did you speak about who came out of prison?
Mandela. Nelson Mandela.
Nelson Mandela.
Yeah.
How did you come to get linked to Nelson Mandela? Jim Jackson?
No, what happened is, of course, we were trying to get him to the United States to raise money for his union.
Okay.
And certainly I was just fortunate by the mayor to pick two or three people to go to South Africa to invite him to come to the United States and try to see what it would take to do just that. And so that's how I got involved in that. But the most part, I was in this home, and basically we were just really just trying to get him to, if he would come to the United States and speak. Mm-hmm. And obviously, everybody wanted to hear from him. This before he became president. But for the most part, it just happens like that, Tony. I can't really explain it that much. I mean, just like I'm here in Uganda. Mm-hmm. I've been in seven countries in Africa, and I always wanted to come to Uganda. It just never happened that way. And then, of course, the lady, the woman of God, invited me here, and I'm just telling you, I'm still trying to figure out, Tony, how did I get here? And
we shall find out. That's the juicy one. Now I want to take you back into how you got into civil rights.
Yeah,
is it suffering? Of course, there was oppression. Might you have been with King when he was marching, when there was that violence? Were you in that one?
I was in the one that he got hit in the head with a brick.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
He was even hit with a brick. By police.
No, it was basically by protesters. And this is in Chicago. And even though I'm from the South of the United States, where we basically march all the time and basically have oppression all the time. But something in the North, you're not supposed to have this kind of, people are supposed to be kind and gentle and non-racial. Okay. In the North, but okay. Somehow in this particular city, it was tough. Mm-hmm. They burned our buses, our cars, and everything else in Chicago. But again, I'm just there. I don't want you to think like I was important to Dr. King. I was just there. But I was there when he got through preaching, and when he would take off his shirt, I would help him with that, with get him off his shirt, and just things like that. I was just a student. That's all I was, Tony, just a student.
Reverend Oli, you are being modest about it. Do you know how many of us would pay to have been there?
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
And your place.
Yeah.
So, now, more interesting is what you had just suggested. How do you get here and deliver a keynote? How did you meet the president's daughter?
We're in Nigeria.
I would like to meet her myself. But, okay.
I was in Nigeria at a conference, the Redeem Christian Church.
Okay.
There's a conference there, called Holy Ghost Conference. And we bumped into my wife and I bumped into her in the lobby. And I just started talking to her, and I started talking to her about the president of Uganda, but I didn't know she was the daughter of the president of Uganda.
Wait a bit. You talked to Patience Museveni Rwabwogo without knowing that she was the daughter of the president.
Right.
And then you were talking about the president.
Right.
Okay.
And somehow
those ways are not ours. Okay.
And she was basically, she said, then after about 20 or 25 minutes, she says, how do you know my father? Oh, that's your father?
Mm-hmm.
And so because I recognized that Uganda is one of the most progressive African countries in Africa. And certainly I've talked to about him. I heard, read about him, and certainly always wanted to come here, but never had the opportunity to come.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I get home, there's a letter saying, you know, I'd like to invite you. And I think she would tell you it's just by God's divine purposing, putting us together.
Okay.
And so I just cannot tell you how proud I am and how humbled I am to be. Can you imagine, Tony, how many people would love to have this opportunity, what I'm having yesterday?
You don't have to explain. You did it when you were delivering that.
Well,
yes,
I just want you to know, but I'm just saying to you, again, a lot of people love to have that opportunity. And I understand that. I understand that. But more than anything else, I just want to also be sort of like a John the Baptist for this wonderful woman of God in the United States. I want to basically do everything I can, as I indicated to you on yesterday. Mm-hmm. I want to do everything I can to make sure that, because I feel like she's really, what you have done is she's a prophetess has risen up in Uganda. And that's who I think she is. She speaks truth to power. The book, Tony, the book basically is so scholarly done. Mm-hmm. I have two doctorates. I did a PhD, and I want you to, I know scholarly work, mm-hmm. and it is what she's done. It's a masterpiece. And to be part of that and try to get this message out on her behalf in the United States, hopefully when she comes, I will have her going from one end of the country to the other, talking about her vision for Africa.
I think I'll not be afraid to state openly that I have not yet read the book.
Right.
But having sat here with you and seen your delivery there, I will read it.
Please.
Have you met patients?
Yes.
Without fear or favor, how do you rate her as an evangelist?
Lovely lady. Mm-hmm. Lovely lady. Mm-hmm. Friendly, mm-hmm. passion, all the good things in her.
The children of very big people are supposed to be very hefty and lordly. And didn't you find these traces in her?
No. She was down to earth.
Down to earth?
Down to earth.
Okay.
I was very comfortable with her. Very nice to us. She was a normal person.
Okay. Yeah. You are in the business of the church. And you've been in the civil rights movement. There are always pressures, especially in countries like ours, of where the clergy should stop in, because you call it civil rights, it could be politics also.
Right.
What is your take on the state and church politics in countries like ours? What do you think could be the role of the clergy?
Yeah, that's a good question you have there. You know, I remember when I went to Israel, to try to put the Palestinians with the with Israel.
Ooh.
And somehow, some kind of way, we thought that the church would have a role to play.
Okay.
It just didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Because somehow, some kind of way, Tony, that politics does not mix with religion. Religion has to take a higher power over politics, and when you do the other way around, it's just not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
Just like in the United States, the same thing is that we come to realize that we have the church has really failed us, if you don't mind me saying so, in the sense that our young people have no idea about history, they have no idea of where we come from. They have
in the United States, thundering typhoons.
I'm just saying to you,
mm-hmm.
because and that's our fault, because we didn't do a good job in really teaching them the generation after generation after generation. And so we're losing. Please understand, we're losing this battle. We're right now 12, I'm 79 years old.
Oh,
and
no.
In 1943, when I was born, the African-American population was less than 12%. Here, after 79 years later, it's still 12%. That doesn't make any sense. You know why? It's simply because of the fact is 30 million black babies have been aborted in the 47 years. 30 million black babies have been aborted. So we have lost.